can make you famous. By the way, my name is.
What is up, guys? It is MoneyShark Gaming here. So last year I did a draft rankings and mock drafts. I did a bunch of draft rankings and mock drafts. Actually, I think I did one final draft rankings, but I did a bunch of mock drafts from about April to June itself when the draft actually happened, where this year I'm just going to do one rankings and one mock draft. Last year I did a top 30 for the rankings. I'm going to do another top 30 where there's tiers and stuff like that, as you can see here. Last year, tier 1, there was only one player, and that was Connor Bedard. Same thing this year. Tier 2 last year was interesting, because last year, tier 2, I had number 2, Matvei Michkov, and then, but number 3, I had a 2A tie. So I had Leo Carlson at 3A last year, and then Adam Fantilli at 3B. Last year in my rankings, basically, when I have two players tied, I just do a 3A or a 3B, or example 2A, 2B, whatever the number is. And I was tempted to do that again this year in tier 2 with Demidov and Levshinov, but you know, somewhere on my channel, if you want to scroll all the way down, I'll have last year's draft stuff. I was definitely off about a lot of stuff looking back at it. I was a little bit too low on Will Smith. Will Smith ended up proving me wrong. I thought there were certain holes in his game that I wasn't sure if he was able to, you know, clean up a little bit. Certain aspects of his game I thought needed some seasoning, and I definitely think going back to Boston College, going to Boston College last year was really good for him. And you know, I feel like he's a lot more seasoned now, and you know, in a redraft I actually probably would have Will Smith in the top, in my top five, so in a re-rank. So you know, in the end of the day, you know, this is all for fun. In the end of the day, these are 17, 18 year olds. Some of them are 19, but probably not going in the first or second round, the overagers. But in the end of the day, like I said, these are really young, you know, teenagers that may or may not make the NHL. It's hard to tell. Like I said, Will Smith's a great example. Like, he had some holes in his game and needed a bit of seasoning. Goes from the U.S. development program, takes a huge step in competition, goes to Boston College, and then ends up becoming, you know, a lot better, and you know, a lot higher than I would expect him to be in a rank. So, like I said, there will be hits, there will be misses. Like last year, I was really high on Edward Schala, had a horrible year. This year was actually better in his draft year than this year. So, but like I said, you know, you could also have a really good year after your draft year and then still be a bust. Like I said, it's still too early to tell, but these are just my rankings as of right now and what I think. So we'll dive into them. Like I said, it'll be interesting to kind of reflect on these next year. But tier one, Macklin Celebrini, no doubt, best player in this draft. So, like Bedard was best player in his draft last year. Now this is where I was talking about tier two. I was very tempted to have a draw, just like I had a draw last year with Fantilli and Carlson. But I do think Demidov has edged out Levshinov with the recent news of Demidov coming to North America and having that little combine. He didn't make the NHL combine, but his agent held a combine for him and a few other Russian players, I think, or international skaters that weren't able to make the scouting combine, and it was legal. From what I know, you know, the Arizona Coyotes, they did something, I think, similar to that. Ended up getting penalized, their 9th overall pick, I think, so, or 11th overall pick, I don't know. I forget what pick it was, but it was a pretty high pick, and they got penalized for doing something like that. But this was held by an agent, to my knowledge, and a bunch of teams got to meet Ivan Demidov, and they were very pleased. He was bigger than projected. He's just under 6'1". He's north of 190 pounds, so you know, a lot of people thought he was going to be about 5'10", 5'11", around 170. He's a lot bigger than they expect, so that's a plus. Really good head on his shoulders, apparently. Like, a lot of scouts are really happy with what they see from Ivan Demidov. Like I said, at the end of the day, whatever drama there is with the whole, you know, Russia, everything going on with Russia, and, you know, these players being in contracts with Russian teams, I don't hold that into account in my rankings. Like, a lot of scouts do. Like, last year, a lot of scouts had Michkov anywhere from 4 to 5th on their rankings. I had him number 2 the whole year, and a lot of scouts' excuses were, hey, listen, if we can't see him play in person, that affects the rankings and also everything going on. He might not come till 2027 to the NHL. And at the end of the day, it's like, who's the best player? That's what the rankings are. Mock drafts and rankings are completely different. And, you know, despite all the drama, I've had Demidov at 2 all year. And same thing I had with Michkov last year, too. Like, at the end of the day, regardless if he came to North America for that combine or not last week, I was still going to have Demidov at 2 in my rankings. But you will see in my mock draft, I'll get into Ivan Demidov and get back to this point about this combine. It does definitely change where I have him in my mock draft. Because last week, I was going to do a mock draft, and I got caught up with, you know, a few things with work and having to fill in on relief and stuff like that. But I was going to make a mock draft last week, and last week I would have actually had Caden Lindstrom at 3 to Anaheim. I thought that Anaheim would pass up on Demidov for a guy like Caden Lindstrom, and I'll get into that later on. But I'm actually going to retract that now, and you'll see in my mock draft soon. But Tier 2, I have Demidov just edging out Levchinov. But these two guys are so close. They've been close all year. These guys have been 2 and 3 all year, basically. For me, basically, yeah. I mean, it's since, I'd say, middle of October, middle of November, I've had Demidov and Levchinov 2 and 3. So we'll stick with that. Levchinov at 3, he's the full package defenseman. I think he's going to go 2 to the Blackhawks. I'll give you guys a little spoiler there, but best defenseman in the draft. No question, in my opinion. Most complete defenseman. He's got size. He's got everything. Right shot. Good offense. Good defense. He's the full package, man. Levchinov is just a stud. I really like this prospect a lot. That's why, like, if the Sharks had the Sharks not won the lottery, I wouldn't have been too bummed out at the idea of getting a Levchinov at 2 or 3, you know? Tier 3, just one step down. I got Sam Dickinson. Sam Dickinson... It was tempting to just leave him in his own realm in Tier 3 and then bump everybody down to Tier 4 in this tier, but Sam Dickinson, I think, outside of Artem Levchinov, he is the best defenseman. Definitely the most complete package outside of Levchinov, in my opinion. In my opinion, you know, if you're picking 4th and you're hoping for a defenseman and Levchinov's gone, I definitely think Dickinson's a great consolation prize as the second best defenseman in this draft. Some people think Ziv Bouyum is the second best defenseman in this draft. Some people will think Zane Parikh is the second best defenseman in this draft. That, you know, the defensemen, they're kind of all over the place. Some people will even think Anton Siliev is the second best defenseman in the draft. I mean, it's all over the place with the rankings this year. This draft is very unique in the sense where, you know, outside of the top three, everything else is kind of all over the place, in my opinion. So, and even the top three, you know, before last week, Demidov, you know, he was even all over the place as well. So, I mean, you never know with these drafts. But, you know, I would say from what I've seen, Sam Dickinson being on the OHL Champions team, you know, him and Bonk were incredible this year on that blue line. And I think Sam Dickinson's the full package. I've been hot about him for the last 2 years. And he's kept a steady pace. I mean, the expectations are very hard to keep up. And Sam Dickinson's done a great job of keeping expectations. I mean, you're going to see as we go down these rankings, a lot of guys had falls from grace, and some people had rose to the occasion in their draft years, but Sam Dickinson's just been so consistent. He's been like a top 10 guy in this draft projected for the last 2 years. I know it's crazy to look at a draft 2 years in advance, but you know, Dickinson's been that good, that consistent, and that steady with his trajectory. So in my opinion, I think Sam Dickinson is the second best defenseman in this draft. Maybe hasn't shown as much offensive upside as a Ziv Bouyum, but I think there is just as much offense there. Some people would disagree, but I think there is just as much offense there in the defensive game. In my opinion, it isn't even close. So Sam Dickinson at 4, in my opinion. Ziv Bouyum at 5th, you know, to some extent, like a smaller Sam Dickinson type player. More seasoned than Sam Dickinson. I think that's another aspect that I do like. He's played a year in the NCAA already in his draft year. I don't think Ziv Bouyum's that far from being an NHL defenseman. So, I mean, in that aspect, I think he could be a very attractive defenseman for a lot of teams. You know, it wouldn't surprise me if Dickinson went ahead of Bouyum, and it wouldn't surprise me if Bouyum went ahead of Dickinson. But, you know, I do like Sam Dickinson a little bit more, but I also like Ziv Bouyum a lot as well. Number 6, we got Cole Yzerman. Cole Yzerman's fallen from grace on a lot of people's rankings, but I don't think he's fallen from grace as far as some of these other guys. I mean, I think Cole Yzerman still had a really good draft year. Is he one-dimensional? Absolutely. But, you know, this reminds me a lot. He reminds me a lot of, like, a left shot, slightly bigger, not slightly bigger. He is bigger. He's like a left shot bigger version of Cole Caulfield in a sense. Like, I feel like the same way Caulfield kind of slipped in his draft for being one dimensional, I think Cole Eiserman, the same thing could happen. But, you know, I think the potential's there. I mean, I think he will be a 30 to 40 goal scorer in the NHL, maybe a 50 goal scorer. Like I said, he's a one dimensional player like Cole Caulfield, but he is a bit bigger than Cole Caulfield. Obviously, he's left-handed where Cole Caulfield's right-handed, but very similar to the other Cole who's come out of the U.S. development program recently, and I still like this player a lot. I like the player a lot. Like, I would still have him in my top six. So, yeah, I mean, I have him number six. Number seven, I have Tiija Ginla. He's a guy who's rose to the occasion, one of those guys like I talked about. You know, really good draft year, had an amazing U18. Couldn't end up being like a Matthew Tkachuk type player. Obviously different. Like, he's more of a shoot first type guy, a little bit less truculent than a Matthew Tkachuk. But when I mean similar to Matthew Tkachuk, I mean where he's ends up being as good as his dad, if not better than his dad. You know, he could be that type of guy, potential franchise player that you get at seven, or he could end up just being a really good role player that could play on your second, third line, like a Max Domi, where he doesn't end up being as good as his dad. So, I mean, these sons of NHL players, they can't be hit or miss at times, but I do like Tiija Ginla's potential, and I do think he could actually be like a Matthew Tkachuk situation where he actually pans out very well. So, we'll have to see about that, but I right now I have number seven. I still like Cole Eiserman more, but Tiija Ginla's a great pick and definitely more well-rounded. Definitely more truculence there, a more well-rounded season game, but Cole Eiserman, I think, just a goal-scoring edges him out there. Caden Lindstrom, really like Caden Lindstrom's game. I thought that was a guy that Anaheim would take a good look at. Some people think that Anaheim's taking a look at Anton Tsalaev as well. If there were two players in the draft outside of Demidov, assuming Levchinov goes second, if Anaheim's picking third, I think the three guys they are having a look at are Demidov. And then outside of Demidov, I would say they're definitely looking at Lindstrom and Tsalaev. We'll get into that soon. But Caden Lindstrom, he's a big body. He's a full package type player. He can be like a Quinton Byfield type player. There is that potential. Reminds me a lot of Pierre-Luc Dubois in his draft year. I know Pierre-Luc Dubois just came off a horrible season. Now he's traded to the Capitals. But Pierre-Luc Dubois, for the first chunk of his career, was a really good player. Very touted player in his draft year just because of that kind of truculence, but also skilled and big guy. Can play center, can play wing. Like, very versatile big forward that will either be a first or second liner in the NHL. And I think that's very attractive to a lot of teams. So, I mean, I think Caden Lindstrom's definitely a guy that could go very high potentially in this draft. And I still think there's a chance a team like Anaheim could draft high on him. But I don't think he's as offensively gifted as a Tiija Ginla or a Cole Eiserman. But he does have the size. But, you know, for the skill reason, I will put him just a couple spots below a Cole Eiserman and a spot below Tiija Ginla. So tier four, Anton Tsalaev. So this is a guy that people are either very high on or very low on. You know, the thing is, Anton Tsalaev, he is 6'7". That is very tempting. But at the end of the day, you have to look at the skill sizes and everything. Size can give you certain skills. Like, you're looking at like Nikita Zadorov. He's a guy that has a lot of size and he knows how to use his size. And for that reason, he's a very coveted player in the NHL. And you'll probably get a 5x5 type of deal in free agency. Very good second pairing defenseman. But he's not a guy that I would take with a third overall pick. You know, like that kind of player with that kind of ceiling. But he is the type of guy that I would pick anywhere from that 8 to 15 range. You know, like 8 to 15. Even 7 to 15, you know, if you end up with a really good top four defenseman who's really big and, you know, that's really hard to find. Even a second pairing defenseman at that kind of size is very hard to find in the National Hockey League. So I definitely think, you know, if I'm picking anywhere from 7 to, you know, 15 in the draft and Tsalaev's there, I definitely would consider it if the guy I really want is not there. Or maybe he is the guy you really want at 7 to 15. You think you lack that, a guy like a Tsalaev in your system. You know, he could go anywhere from 3 to 12, in my opinion. You know, I wouldn't put him lower than 12, probably, just because of what a commodity he would be to a lot of teams. But I'm not as high as him on some of these guys saying that he's the second best defenseman in the draft. I just don't think that's the case. but I do think he's a guy who will be coveted just because of that size. Like, it's basically like getting a slightly bigger version of Zadorov if he pans out fully, you know. But then again, Dmitry Simashev, very similar player last year. I think Siliev is a better version of Dmitry Simashev, and Dmitry Simashev, I didn't even have him in my top 30 last year, just basing it off skill. Simashev ended up going 6 overall. So, I mean, if the right team thinks that a guy like Siliev can help them out down the line and they need a guy like Siliev, I could definitely see a team jumping high on him. I think Siliev is a better version of Simashev last year. You just never know what these teams are thinking. So, I mean, but for me personally, I don't think Siliev's as good as Levshinov, and I definitely don't think he's good as Dickinson or Buyam either. So I have him at 9. Hellenius, this is a guy, moving on to number 10, Konsta Hellenius. This is a guy that I'm very hot on. I think if he was just 2 to 3 inches taller, you know, he would definitely be a top 5 pick, in my opinion. Very, very good player. I think any team that gets him is lucky. I think he's going to be a really good NHL player. Question is, how good is he going to be? Is he going to be a first or second line type guy? I don't know, but I definitely think he does have top 6 potential in the NHL, and you know, he'll be an interesting guy to watch. You know, you could either get a Rupe Hintz or you could get a Michael Granlund out of him. But he's definitely a really good player, and I like him a lot. Berkeley Catton, this is another guy I really like. Really versatile player. Reminds me a lot of Cole Perfetti, Winnipeg Jets player. Just a really good player. Tier 5, Beckett Sinicky, really sold on him. I really like him a lot. Now, this is where it gets interesting. Zane Perich and Carter Yakimchuk. I think these are probably the two best right-shot defensemen in the draft outside of Levshinov. I think Levshinov's by far the best right defenseman in the draft, and I think after that there's a drop-off, and these two guys are that drop-off. Zane Perich, obviously Memorial Cup champion. Very interesting. Very interesting to see where he goes. I do really like Zane Perich. I think Zane Perich, I do see some people saying he has a like Cale Makar type upside, but you know, in my opinion, that's still up for debate. You know, I wouldn't say that he has a full on Cale Makar upside, but I definitely see why people would think that. His offensive game is very good. Probably one of the most offensive gifted defensemen in the draft. I think he is a bit underseasoned. He's one of those question mark guys. I think he'll be a guy who could be a really good offensive second, third pair guy, like Tony DeAngelo, without the temper, obviously. Or he could end up being like a Cale Makar. I mean, he has such a high ceiling, but he also has such a low floor as well. So, I mean, you really don't know what he could be. In my opinion, he's one of those hit or miss picks, and for that reason, I don't have him super high. Kind of the same way I was thinking of Will Smith last year. You know, there are certain holes in his game, but with Will Smith, he was able to go take a step up in competition and go to Boston College. With Zane Perich, he doesn't have that option. He doesn't have that option to go to the NCAA because he's in the CHL. And he doesn't have the option to go to the AHL either. So he's going to be playing against lower competition still. I don't see how the lack of seasoning gets solved. You look at Cale Makar too. I mean, he played in the BCHL, I think, his draft year, and then went to Denver and became seasoned, and then became one of the best defensemen in the NHL. I just don't see that route of seasoning until Zane Perich is old enough to be in the AHL. And I think it's going to be a long road for Zane Perich. That's just my opinion. But a lot of people are very high on him, especially after his Memorial Cup performance. So we'll have to see about that. Next best right shot defenseman after Zane Perich is Carter Yakimchuk. That one I was kind of torn on to put who higher than who, Yakimchuk or Perich. But I think just because of the offensive upside and his Memorial Cup performance, I would put Zane Perich ahead of Yakimchuk. But I think Yakimchuk's more of the full package out of the two. I think Yakimchuk is like a lesser version of a Sam Dickinson, in a sense, less mobile too, but very complete. Definitely a guy who's, you know, rose to the occasion in his draft year. Definitely a guy who's had a big jump. I like Carter Yakimchuk a lot, you know, so I think he's the more well-rounded option out of the two, but I do think Zane Perich is a little bit better as a prospect. So I like Carter Yakimchuk's game as well. Tier 6. Tier 6 is a tier where you're going to see some guys who fell from grace, especially these top two guys in Tier 6, Aaron Kivihiaru and Adam Juracek. So Aaron Kivihiaru, he was projected to be like a top 5 pick at the beginning of the year, ends up getting injured, fall from grace. Same with Adam Juracek. He's another guy who had like a fall from grace just due to injuries. So I still like both these guys. These guys are a little bit high on my rankings, but I think, you know, you can't judge a player off injuries. You know, you've seen guys who were injured in their draft years slipped and then ended up becoming NHL superstars. Like a good example recently is Wyatt Johnson. Wyatt Johnson barely played in his draft year and then ends up becoming a stud. So, I mean, there is a lack of activity, which is why I even have them this low in the first place. But at the beginning of the year, both these guys were arguably the two best defensemen in the draft outside of Levchinov, so, and maybe Dickinson. So, I mean, I would still take a risk on them if I had to pick anywhere from 15 to 20 and the guys I like aren't there. You know, I definitely think it's worth it. So moving down the list, Cole Hutson, like Adam Juracek, has an older brother from the 2022 draft. David Juracek is Adam Juracek's older brother. He was in the 2022 draft. And then Cole Hutson, obviously the younger brother of Lane Hutson, who is from the 2022 draft. So Cole Hutson, I really like his game. I think he reminds me a lot of his brother. Could end up being a steal type of pick. A lot like Zane Parikh. Obviously, you know, not as big as Zane Parikh, but one of those guys like Zane Parikh where the offense is there. The question is, you know, the ceiling's high, but how low is the floor and where does he end up, you know? Henry Muse, I also like him a lot. We'll try to get through this quick and start the mock draft. I mean, the rest of the list speaks for itself. I mean, you can kind of look at it. A few guys I have pretty high, like Clark Caswell. You know, he had a bit of a fall from grace, but I still like his game. The rest you can have a look real quick, and then we'll get into the mock draft.
Mock draft. So as you can see, I have the rankings on the right and my rankings on the right, and I have the mock draft on the left, just the first round. So picks 31 and 32 could be intertwined. You know, the Stanley Cup Finals not done yet, so that could obviously be swapped around. But the top 30, I mean, those picks are already set. But yeah, I mean, here's my mock draft. Macklin Celebrini, tier one, number one, he goes number one. So number two, I think Levchinov. At this point, the Blackhawks would be picking positional, but at the same time, I wouldn't say he's the best player available, but it's so close. Like, I have them on the same tier. I think it's like a game of inches at that point between Demidov and Levchinov, and I think that the Blackhawks, because of how close they are, they would go with Levchinov. I do think they'll take a good look at Demidov, but I do think they'll go with Levchinov there too. So number three, so this is what I was getting back to. By the way, the rankings on the left, it's interesting. I'll show you guys after about that. But if you go to the rankings on, if you see the rankings on the left, this website, as you can see, NHL entry draft / mock draft or whatever, you can click, go on the website, type it in, what you see on the URL there. So there's two rankings they have. They have the FC hockey rankings, which is theirs, and then they have like another scouts ranking, which I forget. One of their rankings looks completely different than the other. Like this one's definitely a very off the board type rankings from what I saw. Like they had Levchinov at 10th when, you know, 90 to 95% of consensus rankings have Levchinov going top three for sure. So, and they have him ranked in the top three as well. So, I mean, I don't know what they're thinking there, but yeah, back to Anaheim. Like I said, had you asked me a week ago who they would take, I would lean towards a Caden Lindstrom or a Anton Seliev. You know, if you look at how Anaheim's building their team lately, I mean, look at their last three drafts. I mean, they draft Mason McTavish third overall 2021, and then they draft Mintikoff 10th 2022, and then they draft Leo Carlson second overall in 2023. If you look at, and they also traded their 2020 first round pick Drysdale for Cutter Gauthier. So there is a trend there that Anaheim is going. Since Pat Verbeek took over, they want to be a hard team to play against. They want to be a team that is, they want to be a team that's four lines deep. They want to be a team that is hard to play against, a big physical team that's good, responsible defensively. They want to pick players that are very versatile and players that are hard to play against. And that's why I was leaning towards a Caden Lindstrom or Anton Seliev. I feel like they both fill holes to some extent that they're trying to fill. You know, they're like Anaheim, like I said, if you look at their top six, the guys they're trying to fill out in that top six, just tough guys that are hard to play against. Like, Mason McTavish, big, strong two-way forward. Leo Carlson, big, strong two-way forward. You can either play him on the wing or you can play him at center. You know, on the wing, he can be a two-way slash power forward down the middle. He's just a big, you know, two-way forward who's hard to play against down the middle, Leo Carlson, that is. And then they acquire Cutter Gauthier, kind of like a similar type player to a Mason McTavish, can play wing, can play center. Mason McTavish, I'd say, is more of a pure centerman, but, you know, Cutter Gauthier is kind of like Carlson, where he can play wing, he can play center, but similar to McTavish in the way that he's just got that mean streak to him, and very, 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 just very hard to play against. So that's those are kind of the guys they want to build their forward groups around, like guys like Leo Carlson, Mason McTavish, Cutter Gauthier. They might be moving on from Trevor Zegras, maybe, maybe not. Either way, like, he's kind of like a one-off type of guy. I feel like in 2019 they picked him because he was just by far the best player available at that point. Like, he slipped so far, and it was a no-brainer to not pick him. And that was also when Bob Murray was in charge before Pat Verbeek. So, I mean, but the direction Pat Verbeek seems to be going is just big and strong. Maybe have a one skill guy there like Zegras, whether he stays or not. But for the most part, they're trying to be built big and strong. I mean, even look at a guy like Troy Terry, who they signed long term. Very hard to play against, big winger, responsible both ends of the ice. Like, there's a certain direction Anaheim's going. But with the recent news about Ivan Demidov, he's a lot bigger than we expected. You know, a lot of, you know, scouts had him at 5'10", 5'11", about 160 to 170 pounds. He's north of 190 pounds, and he's north of 6 foot. He's almost 6 foot one. So, had a good head on his shoulders, apparently. A lot of scouts were really pleased with Ivan Demidov and getting to meet him at that agent host combine. So, like I said, had you asked me a week ago, I would have leaned towards Caden Lindstrom. I think he's the type of player that they're trying to build around, their team around. But at the same time, Ivan Demidov, he's just the best player available. And I think he's a skill guy that can fit in very nicely. Like, let's say you have a line of Leo Carlson and Demidov and Trevor Zegras, and then you have Cutter Gauthier and Mason McTavish and Troy Terry. I mean, it's a nasty top six, and I think this sets up Anaheim very well for the future. You could also go Salayev. Salayev, I think there are rumors there looking at him too, and I could definitely see that. Very hard to play against, big defenseman. You know, Mintikov is a guy who can play on both sides, so you could have Salayev on the left and then Mintikov on the right. That would be a very dynamic Russian duo. But at the end of the day, I think they take best player available now at this point. Like I said, a week ago you asked me who they're taking, I would lean towards, if you asked me a week ago the top three guys that they're looking at, I would say Lindstrom 1, Salayev 2, and then Demidov 3. And now I would probably say they're looking at Demidov as their first option, and then probably Lindstrom, and then Salayev. I don't think Salayev's much of an option for them anymore. But number four, I think the Jackets take Lindstrom. He's kind of fitting in that same mold that, you know, Anaheim's kind of going down. They want big, strong forwards. Reminds me a lot of Pierre-Luc Dubois in his draft year, in some sense, in a lot of aspects, a better version of Pierre-Luc Dubois. Can play wing, can play center, very versatile. The same way Columbus was very attracted to Pierre-Luc Dubois in his draft year, I feel like they're very attracted to Caden Lindstrom. I think that seems like a slam dunk pick for them based on their positional needs. I think they'd feel very comfortable with Caden Lindstrom. Adam Fantilli is like their 1-2 punch down the line. So, I mean, we'll see. I definitely think Caden Lindstrom seems to be the pick there. They could go Salayev. They could go Dickinson, but I do think that they'll go with Lindstrom there. Number five, I think they go Montreal goes Tiija Ginla. I think that's a no-brainer. It just seems like a no-brainer pick for me, for them to go with Tiija Ginla, like, based on positional needs and everything. I think Ginla's a guy who could end up like a Matthew Tkachuk, where he ends up being as good as his dad, if not better than his dad. You know, that truculence, that goal scoring, he could bring it all on the wing. I would love to see Ginla on that Montreal Canadiens team. Number six, I think Sam Dickinson's a no-brainer for Utah. If you really look at, you know, their needs and everything. I just think he's a no-brainer, in my honest opinion. So I would go Sam Dickinson at 6. I heard there are rumors that Philadelphia is trying to trade up to number 7. What I think Philadelphia is thinking is that Dickinson might be there at 7. They might trade up to number 7 regardless. They might have a plan B as well. Like, I remember Columbus, they almost traded up in 2015 to get Noah Hanifin or Zach Werenski. But they felt like, hey, you know, we're probably going to get Zach Werenski. That's our plan B. We're pretty comfortable with our plan B. So Philadelphia could feel pretty comfortable with their plan B and stay at 12 or, you know, trade up just to solidify their plan B. But I think their plan A is Sam Dickinson. I don't think that will be fulfilled unless they somehow get Utah's pick. And I just don't see that happening. I think Dickinson and Bonk were so good together. The Philadelphia Flyers are trying to make everything they can to make that happen. But I just think Sam Dickinson at 6 to Utah makes too much sense. You know, basically like a better, more mobile version of Jacob Chychrun. It's just a no-brainer. Ottawa, if they keep the pick, I think Zeev Bouyum would be the option. I think if Philadelphia trades up, Zeev Bouyum would probably be their plan B as well. So I think at number 7, no matter what, it's probably Zeev Bouyum. Number 8, I think it's Anton Seliev. I think he makes a lot of sense for the Kraken. I just think it's just a no-brainer pick. They could use a big young defenseman like that. Like I said, no-brainer pick. I think the Seattle Kraken are one of those teams that, you know, will jump up and take Seliev the same way that a team jumped up and took Simashev last year. It's just a no-brainer. I think the Calgary Flames go with Senecky. I think they would want a Ginla, but I don't see a Ginla being there. So I think he's kind of like the next best thing for that type of player. I think the New Jersey Devils take Cole Eisman. I think he's the best player available by far here. And I think that they take him. I mean, I wouldn't say by far. I mean, Hellenius is pretty damn good too, but I definitely think he is the best option there. And the idea of Cole Eisman developing into a really good goal scorer, you pair him with Jack Hughes in 3 to 4 years, could be a very, very, very dynamic duo. So I think Cole Eisman, if they keep the pick, is just such a no-brainer for them. Hellenius, you know, Buffalo, I think that's a nice little pick there for sure. Very skilled player. Like I said, I think if Hellenius was a bit bigger, he would be a top 5 pick easily. I would go with Hellenius if I was Buffalo. I think Zane Parikh for Flyers is a no-brainer at that point. You know, they could use a really mobile offensive right-shot defenseman. Just a no-brainer pick. I think Berkeley Cadden's a no-brainer for Minnesota as well. You know, they want to improve down the middle. I think Berkeley Cadden has the potential to be number one or number two center, a lower end number one or a high end number two center. I like that pick a lot. For the Sharks, this is a tough one. I was kind of, if they keep the pick, that's if they keep the pick, they might trade back to a team like Carolina if they're able to put a package towards Nietzsche's. You know, maybe that intrigues Carolina, the opportunity to move up from, what is it, like 27 or something to 14. Let's say San Jose gives up a few good players, a few NHL roster players, a few decent prospects, and a 14th pick to move back to the 27th pick and Marty Nejes. I think that's a deal that could happen. But if San Jose keeps the 14th pick, I think Carter Yakimchuk's a no-brainer. I was kind of leaning back and forth between Emery, Yurecek, and Yakimchuk, but I think Carter Yakimchuk, he's just the full package there. Just a full baggage right shot defenseman. He's rose to the occasion in his draft year, and you know, I like that pick a lot. Red Wings, I think they go with the Scandinavian Nygaard. I think that's kind of a no-brainer. St. Louis, I think they go Greentree. That's kind of like a Doug Armstrong type of pick. I think Washington goes with Michael Hage. Similar to Ryan Leonard last year, like I said, I try to find teams' tendencies and also their positional needs as well. If there isn't a glaring positional need that's available around that best player available mark, then I usually go for his tendencies. And I think that Michael Hage, not the exact same player as Ryan Leonard, but there are similarities, and I think that's a pick they'll go with. I think Chicago will go with EJ Emery. They're pretty comfortable with that U.S. development program, and you know, I could see them using a guy like EJ Emery as kind of like a Connor Murphy replacement down the line in 4 or 5 years. I like that pick. I think Vegas picks Juracek. I'll go with Connolly to the Islanders, Maxime Massé to the Kings, Emil Hemming to the Predators. They like their Finnish guys. Henry Muse to Toronto. That's another guy I was considering for San Jose at 14. I definitely do want a right shot defenseman in the first round for San Jose. I think Henry Muse is a no-brainer for Toronto Maple Leafs. I really like his game. I think Colorado takes a chance on Kiviharu. I think Basha to the Senators is solid. I go Spencer Gill, Montreal Canadiens. I do think there is a chance they will take a solid look at Cole Hudson to put him with his brother Lane Hudson, but I think they will go with the big defenseman in Spencer Gill. So I'll go with Solberg to the Hurricanes, another big defenseman. I'll go Tanner Howe, Regina Pats to the Flames. They like picking their WHL guys. Like I said, I try to look for tendencies. Igor Surin, I'm pretty high on him. Dallas likes their Russians as well, so I think that's a pretty solid pick for them. And I think Cole Hudson actually ends up going to the New York Rangers. They end up getting another steal from the U.S. development program in the late first round like they did last year with Perreault. So, like I said, I think Hudson's a perfect pick for them. Anaheim, I think they go with Richie. And same with, I think Philadelphia goes with Stiga, no matter what. So I think even if Anaheim picks at 32, they'll end up with Richie, and I think Philadelphia will end up with Stiga. So that's my final mock draft for the first round. Obviously, like I said, 31, 32 could be swapped. Let me know what you guys think. Thank you guys for watching, and have a great day.